listen, I'll talk about Napoleon, and then we'll listen to the 1812 overture, and we'll listen to it, and I'll point out where Tchaikovsky is really spinning this stuff, because we're gonna chart our way through spins on either side, I hope. The first spin was, I talked to some friends, we were in Moscow, we were standing at a spot on a bluff over the river, and I asked him if this was the place where Napoleon first laid eyes on Moscow after marching 700 miles from the border, right? Well, he didn't march, he rode. But they said, no, this is where the Master and Margarita, for those of you who read it, said goodbye to Moscow. That actually the spot where Napoleon first saw Moscow was about 4 miles to the west from here, and you could barely make out this hill. It's called Naklonnaya Gora, and that's where it is. And if you want to see the spot where Napoleon first saw Moscow, just you get in the subway and you go to a very large, very important subway station, Park Pagyadi, and you go up there, and you can see the spot. And Park Pagyadi means the Park of Victory. Made sense to me, you know, Napoleon got his butt kicked. So here it is. This is the victory, right? Well, it isn't that victory. It's a different victory. It's a victory over fascism. The victory in World War II. And I looked all over that damn bluff to find the plaque that had to be there, I thought. Marking the spot where it is accepted that Napoleon first laid eyes on Moscow. It ain't there. I couldn't find it. You may know where it is, maybe you can tell me after. But I thought there would be a neon hand like this pointing to the very spot. There was nothing. Rather, there was a celebration of something else. And right off this tells you, if you know the Russians, something's going on. In the meantime, I had a friend who visited Paris, and he went to Les Invalides, where Napoleon has his tomb. And there, carved in jasper, under his sarcophagus, are all his conquests. And one of his great conquests, supposedly, was Moscow. And I'm thinking to myself, the Russians are sort of distancing themselves from it, and he is claiming credit for it. So what the hell is going on? You listen to the 1812 overture, of course it's this incredible triumph of the Russians over Napoleon. But isn't that strange that somehow or other people on the Russians are covering up the traces of it and the French are turning it into a full-fledged victory? So I started looking at things. And to begin with, Napoleon comes out of a period in the 18th century, the period of the Enlightenment. And the Enlightenment meant a lot of different things to a lot of different people. But basically, if you sort of put it in a sifter and sift it down, the basic things that they are talking about are, one, secularization. Take all of what would become science, it wasn't known as science back then, and you deal with it on the one hand, and religion on the other hand. The other thing that's very important in the Enlightenment is the role of the governed in the government. You can't just say, you know, this is the law, go ahead and do it. Another thing is that you have to have some kind of a law code. In other words, a law code is a very peculiar thing. It's a statement of what it is you can't do beforehand, right? What it is you can't do, and what will happen to you if they pin it on you. That's a big deal, and it's not new. It goes all the way back to Hammurabi and before that, but the Napoleonic code that Napoleon put together is used to this day. It's based on Roman law, not on English common law, like ours. But it's used for matters of personal property, belongings and so on and so forth, divorce, right across the river in Louisiana. And if you don't know that, it's probably because you've never seen Tennessee Williams' Streetcar Named Desire. Because in Streetcar Named Desire, Stanley Kowalski lectures Stella about what is his and what is his property, and because here we have the Napoleonic Code, and of course Stanley got it just absolutely ass backwards. But on the other hand, you know, consider the source. My wife and I, our daughter was studying Polish in Krakow, and we had a sort of a B&B. And I was walking down towards the center of the city, and there on our street was the Summer Stock Theater. And they had a listing of all their plays, and believe it or not, honest to God, they had a Polish translation of Tennessee Williams called Streetcar Named Desire. Can you imagine playing Stanley Kowalski in Krakow, in Polish? I mean, just make sure nobody finds out your address. They're going to burn your house down. But anyway, enough. Napoleon is equipping the new French Republic with a lot of the ideas of the Enlightenment. And he is considered to be quite a hero for doing it. He calls himself the first consul, as in consult, of the French Republic. Republics were a big deal because the idea was rather than empires, you would have fairly small republics that were linguistically and ethnically more or less homogeneous. And the reason is they don't fight with each other, whereas if you have empires, you're going to have power grabs, for turf. Basically, they're going to fight over turf. And that was one of the big things that came out of the Enlightenment, was this idea of republics. And Napoleon fostered this, and for those of you, we have a music friend. For those of you who are interested in archaeology, you can do some musical archaeology. And you put on Beethoven's Third Symphony, which he called the Eroica. And the hero in the Eroica is none other than Napoleon. And in the first movement, it's this heraldic, wonderful bit of music. And then Napoleon declared himself interested in becoming emperor, and reestablishing the French Empire and making himself emperor. He does an absolute 180. All of a sudden, there's no republic. There's an empire. They had had a separation of church and state. The Pope was at his coronation, if you can believe it. Didn't preside, but was there. And Beethoven writes the second movement, which is a funeral dirge. Same thing repeating over and over. And it gets madder and madder and madder and madder until he, if you pardon, well, this is, it varies with different conductors, but we had Von Karajan with the Berlin Phil on Deutsche Grammophon, and I swear at the end of the second movement, Napoleon pisses on his grave. I mean, he is that furiously, nasty, angry, and it was that change in people's attitude toward Napoleon that reflected this sort of about the face where he had himself coronated as Pope. And that's as emperor. And the Pope was there. So he's going to become an emperor. And the problem with that, of course, is an emperor's got to have a big army. And the army had been destroyed. They were starting from the ground up. He needed money. So where's he going? Get money? Got it from us. What he did was he sold the Louisiana Territory, which belonged to the French, to Thomas Jefferson, he of the separation of church and state, $15 million, he went out and bought himself a lot of weapons. Now, the design of the musket that he ordered was nothing special. A muzzle-loading musket has two flaws in it. One, the outside diameter of the ball you shoot has to be smaller than the inside diameter of the barrel. Otherwise, you can't get that sucker down there. Right? The muzzle loader, loaded from the muzzle. And what happens is, when the charge goes off, the ball tends to bounce from side to side in the barrel, and it comes out such that if I aim it over here, the ball might very well come out that way. Just clean off the barrel like that. The other problem is, once the ball issues from the muzzle of the musket, you're throwing a knuckleball. There's no spin. And when I played baseball in high school, we used to refer to a knuckleball as a butterfly, because it would just go all over the place. Bob Uecker, who was a very famous catcher, professional catcher, always said that the best way to catch a knuckleball was to wait for it to stop rolling and then go over and pick it up. They are just unbelievably erratic in flight. So what are you going to do if you got a whole bunch of people armed with incredibly inaccurate guns? What you do is you mass people together so that accuracy really wasn't much of an issue. They didn't care. You know, load the thing, make sure it's ready to go, fire it, and you'll hit something. That was it. The real innovation that Napoleon had in his weaponry was in cannon. He had two cannons. He had a smaller one, and he had one that had a muzzle about 4.5 inches wide. And it would fire what they called round shot, which is your basic cannonball. They were very handy on the lever because it would bounce along, and woe betide anybody who got in the way. But the thing that really made them unbelievably deadly was the fact that they used to fire something called grape shot. Now, you guys know what birdshot is. It's basically, it's a plastic tube that's crimped at the end, charge goes off, a whole bunch of lead BBs come shooting out this tube and out the muzzle of the gun, and your bird is toast. Now, buckshot is the same principle, but the shot is bigger. It's bigger around, it's heavier. And same thing, same size barrel, 10 gauge or 12 gauge, about 3/4 of an inch. You fire it, and that's it for the deer. Now, grape shot is not to shoot at grapes. Okay? There's been a switch in what we literary theorists say call tropes. Bird shot, buck shot involve metonymy, the thing that's associated with them. Whereas grape shot is metaphor. It's firing balls that are the size of grapes. And they just slaughtered. And remember how they have the men in very, very tightly packed in squares. And they would fire at them, they would fire above them, they would hit the ground, and it would explode. These things were just unbelievable. And Napoleon has to know that the men that he engages, the Russians, he's got trouble. The number of men are going to fall like crazy when they encounter these weapons. Now, the Russians didn't have anywhere near as good weapons, but they had plenty of them. They had enough, as it turned out, more than enough. The other thing that he has to worry about, and he probably wasn't aware of it, was something called camp fever. Now, you take a whole bunch of men of, let's be generous, indifferent hygiene, and you put them together for a long enough time, and what happens is sickness spreads. And it's called camp fever. And George Washington,
with the Continental Army.
In Pennsylvania, in the winter of 76, got to what he thought was a use-it-or-lose-it moment with his army due to camp fever. And so what he do, he put them all in boats, rolled across the Delaware River, and snuck up on Trenton from behind. And the Brits were just really surprised to see him there. And so we had this heroic notion of Washington crossing the Delaware, and indeed it is, but the fact was he knew he had to do it. That is going to be a problem for Napoleon too. But to get back to the cannon, the thing that makes them so useful at that time was the fact that they were light. They were made of bronze or brass. They could be easily machined, they could be quickly machined, and they could be carried on sort of half a carriage, on a gun carriage, on a caisson. And you could take these things around the battlefield, wherever they were needed, and you could take them all the way to Moscow. But you had to have the equines. And the equines, the mules and the horses, have to be fed. They don't call them hay burners for nothing. They have to be fed. And Napoleon has to wait until the 24th of June, 1812, to invade. Now, what's wrong with that?
It's late.
It's very late. Because winter is only October away. And the Tsar, the Russian Tsar, has said that the two best allies that Russia has are her winter and her size. And so here's Napoleon. He has pretty much wrapped up all of Western Europe. He fights off a coalition of the Austrians, the Russians, and the Holy Roman Empire in 1805 at the Battle of Austerlitz. And he had the Russians right in the palm of his hand. And all he had to do was squeeze. And that would have been it for the Russians. But he gets this idea, you see. Who the hell wants to go way out there where it's cold and it's, you know, you're a long way from Paris and so on and so forth. So what he says, he goes to the Tsar. And he says, look, you rule the Eastern. I'll rule the Western half. I'll tell you what to do, and you will do it. And Alexander the First apparently was in no position to argue. So okay. So this is 1805. By 1808, it ain't working. It ain't working big time. And Napoleon knows that he's got to teach this upstart a thing or two. So what he does is he takes a huge army of over a half a million men. This is enormous, unheard of at the time. And he lines them up at this Niemen River at the border. This is the Russian Empire from here to here. He lines them up on the border of the French Empire. And in the fourth week of June, he invades Lithuania. Now, Lithuania is the farthest west country in the Russian Empire. And he crosses to the capital of Vilnius in about 2 days, unopposed. And from Vilnius, we have what turns out to be an isosceles triangle. If we put Moscow way out here, the distance from the Niemen River to Moscow is 700 miles, rough, which is from here to Fort Lauderdale. They're going to walk. They don't call them foot soldiers. And it's 600 miles from Vilnius. I'll figure around 100 to Vilnius. And then this will be, will start southeast, and then it will go due east here for another 600 miles. Vilnius, Russia has two capitals at the time. They have St. Petersburg up here, which is about 400 miles from Vilnius. Okay? So we've got 600 miles that way, 400 that way. And it turns out that even though my map doesn't show it, Moscow is about 400 miles from St. Petersburg. So essentially, you're looking at an isosceles triangle. The sides of the triangle are 400 miles long. The base is 600. St. Petersburg is the administrative capital of Russia. It's only about 100 years old. It was founded by Peter the Great at the beginning of the 18th century. That's where all the embassies are, all the diplomats. That's where the seat of the government was so on. So you can think of St. Petersburg as the brain of Russia. Moscow is the historic capital. There are references to it that go back to the 12th century. This is the seat of the Orthodox, Russian Orthodox religion, and it is the heart and soul of Russia. So Napoleon has a choice. He can either decapitate Russia, or he can rip out its heart. Which one will it be? Heart. And so he goes for the heart. But not after giving a head fake to the northeast. And of course the Russians have to move around to stop him there. And then basically he throws, Napoleon throws the lion's share of his army southeast and then east to Moscow. So Alexander I, the emperor, the Russian emperor, again knows that his two greatest allies are Russia's size and its empire. And Napoleon has been fighting in Western Europe, still in Spain. He's having a hard time conquering Spain because what happens is he's very aggressive. He tends to attack, attack, attack. And what they do, and what Wellington, the English commander, does, is he sneaks around behind them and cuts off his lines of resupply and communication. And so this is not lost on Alexander I. So he starts retreating. And boy, you should hear how Tchaikovsky has to sort of deal with that one. It's really amusing. And here, after about a month at a pig wallow named Vitebsk, and this is Lithuania, and this is Belarusia, and then it'll include Vitebsk, and then all of this out here is Russia itself. At Vitebsk, on the 23rd of July, he says, hey, wait a minute. What's happening? He can't catch the Russians. The Russians keep retreating and retreating and retreating and pulling him in deeper and deeper. And people in history, we know about that. The Russians do that. They draw you in, they draw you in, and then they encircle you. But he starts out here with a 3-1 advantage over the Russians. Wherever he decides to go, he's got a 3-1 advantage. By the time he gets to Vitebsk, he's got a 2-1 advantage. And it's got nothing to do with engagement or anything like that. It has to do with campaign. These Western European effete snobs contact the Slavic peasantry, and they start dropping like flies. Now, the peasants themselves have to have some kind of a resistance to, as it turned out, typhus. Otherwise, they'd be dead. But his Western Europeans, the Swede, the Swiss, the Italians, and so on, the Dutch, they didn't. They had no resistance whatsoever. And typhus is born vectored by vermin. And the vermin that vectors typhus best is, anybody?
Lice.
And so what happens is he gets into these areas, his soldiers start coming in contact with peasants, they start itching because the lice are beginning to take up life in their uniforms and so on. So, and his guys start reporting for sick call. He's down 1/3 at DJ. Okay? He hadn't even fired a shot. He's got another, the Russians have another army. Already about 30,000 people, well equipped, experienced, and so on and so forth. But they're way the hell down here on the Danube. They've been fighting the Turks. The Russians are always fighting the Turks through the 18th, 19th, and beginning of the 20th century. Just always. And if they're down here and they're 1,000 miles out of the theater, you don't worry about it, do you? Well, maybe you do. Maybe you should, because while they are VJFs, and it's about 7:23, let's say, they find out that that army that's been fighting the Turks has been freed up for 2 whole months, and it is running as fast as it can up to get up into the theater. And here is Napoleon here, and he's got a little problem. Here he was the aggressor. You could end up surrounded by a large number of well-armed, very, very pissed-off Russians. So he realizes that he can't stay there, that he has to continue, and he has to do what it was that he set out to do all along, which is destroy the Russian army. He's got a 2-to-1 advantage. All he has to do is catch the Russians out in the unprotected by walls or whatever. All he has to do, and he'll smash them. And he knows that, the Russians know that too. And so what he does, and it's really interesting, he takes a bunch of his healthy men and he goes south. And it turns out, let's go here, there's a river called the Dnieper River, which is unfordable. And he goes to a town that has a bridge about 100 miles south called Orsha. He crosses dry foot the Dnieper. And he tries to come up on the first truly Russian city, Smolensk. Now, Smolensk, as you look at this, it works out pretty well. Smolensk is over halfway from Vilnius to Moscow. Vitebsk is a little bit under halfway, but Smolensk is the whole way. And his idea was the Russians have this army that's strung out along this road. He'll fall on their left flank, he'll cut them to pieces, or he'll get around behind them and surround them and hit them. And so what he does, he comes over the hill and he looks down at Smolensk, and the Russian army, the rear guard, is just going like that. They take the dart and they slam it in his face. And Smolensk, it turns out, is a walled city. So what choice does he have? He has to look at. And this is, you'll hear this in the 1812 or what you the first time.
That's fine.
They fought for a couple days. They burned the city to the ground. The rear guard did what a rear guard is supposed to do. What's a rear guard supposed to do? Guard the rear, right? So they guard the rear of the Russian army, and the Russian army is able to retreat from Smolensk. But there are a couple things. One, the Russians know where he's going. Up to about this stage, he could always turn to the left and head towards St. Petersburg. It's highly unlikely, but they still had to plan for it. Now they don't have to plan for it. So all the forces that are up here to protect St. Petersburg can come down. And at the meantime, that army down here on the Danube is galloping up, cavalry first, light infantry next, as fast as they can make it up. They, in the analysis of the battle, it ended pretty much in a tie, in a wash. The problem was that Napoleon couldn't afford a wash, could not afford a tie. This was advantage Russia. Furthermore, the Tsar was coming in for a lot of criticism for not engaging Napoleon, for letting him get away, for letting him threaten the heart and soul of Mother Russia. So what Alexander I does is he steps down as commander and he brings in the guy who was down on the Danube fighting the Turks, a guy by the name of Kutuzov. And Kutuzov is the hero of the peace. Kutuzov was an old geezer. Kutuzov was 68 years old. Kutuzov used to nod off at staff meetings, if you can imagine. Kutuzov, there's one point. There are various generals there, and Kutuzov says, oh, this Polish general, shap, 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 you know, and this shap is exactly to the Russian ear what Polish sounds like, you know, which is sort of just nonsense. Anyway, he was morbidly obese. He'd been shot in the orbit of the right eye and was blind, wore an eye patch. He was a pretty disgusting guy, except he was a brilliant tactician. Alexander I goes back up to St. Petersburg to his day job, turns everything over to Kutuzov. And what does Kutuzov do? He retreats. But the Russians, they now know where he's going. And they depopulate the area. You know what that means? Is you chase them out, and if they don't leave, you kill them. And they practice scorched earth all the way in from Smolensk all the way in. So there is absolutely nothing ahead of the French army. There is nothing to eat. There's no forage for their animals. And he backs up and backs up and backs up until he comes to a place called Baradjinov. Now, this is fascinating to me because if you look at Baradjinov and you erase all the names, and you look at it, it looks like the Bull Run. It looks like battle after battle in the American Civil War. There is a road. The aggressor will come down the road. There is a valley with a stream running through it. The stream and a bridge, if there is one, will provide a choke point. The defenders will be up high and will have what are called redoubts, which are armed hills. They'll place all their artillery up there, and they will, as Shelby Foote would say, pour galling fire fascinating thing, that in the Battle of Concord, here in our Revolutionary War, there were under 30 casualties in the whole battle. And this was one of the shots heard around the world. The other one was Leipzig. In this battle, the Battle of Buttercup Law, they will drop at an average rate of about 2 per second for 8 to 10 hours. There were 70,000 casualties in one day. They set a record for massacre, which wasn't broken until World War I. And by the time World War I came along, they had all kinds of new massacre machines. They had machine guns and so on. This is those muskets throwing knuckleballs and those cannon. Over 70,000 casualties. So this is the big one. And the 1812 overture. This is where you hear the cannon going off and so on. This is the battle itself was September 7th. There was a preliminary battle on the 6th. The Russians arrayed themselves. On their left, they had a redoubt called the Shevardino Redoubt. In the middle, they had a redoubt called Ryazky Redoubt. And on the far right, there was Forest and the Moscow River. So the far right was pretty well defended. And Napoleon, obviously enough, attacked the left. And he took the Shevardino Redoubt on the 6th of September. Battle opens up on the 7th. The French open up with their artillery. At 6 o'clock in the morning, the Tule fog hasn't burned off yet, but he knows where the Russians are down in the middle of the valley, and they start firing. Ryazky Redoubt is the place where the real battle raged. And for those of you who know literature or who have read War and Peace or will ever read War and Peace, and you should, it's a good book. Tolstoy's description of the battle of Buttercup and particularly what went on at Ryazky's Redoubt is wonderful. It was taken briefly by the French and the Russians were able to take it back. So anyway, the battle ends late in the afternoon when the soldiers are too tired to lift their arms, let alone load them, aim them, and fire them. They're dead. Napoleon thinks he won. And just about everybody other than Kutuzov himself, the old commander, that old guy who is deluded or demented or whatever, he thinks he won. So Napoleon has an imperial guard of over 10,000 people, and the brass helmets and the ostrich feathers, and they're all on livery horses and so on and so forth. And he doesn't commit them that day, the 7th. If he had committed his imperial guard, they could have gone down and just killed off the wounded, which was the way they did then. And he would have gotten what he came for, which was to smash the Russian line. But he held back. I think he held back because he figured that he had won. And two, his ego was so huge that he wanted to have those groovy guys in brass helmets, trotting beside him when he went into Moscow. So this is under 100 miles from Moscow. September 7th. So Napoleon wakes up, says, okay guys, we gotta clean up. And he looks and he sees, my God, the Russian army is retreating, perhaps limping, but retreating in order from the field. And he has no choice but to go try to catch it. So outside of of Moscow on this, looking at it from back here, from the polling standpoint, on September 14th, 1812, he lays eyes after this 700-mile schlep, and he lays eyes on Moscow. Kutuzov is under tremendous pressure to fight him. But Kutuzov, you know, the old guy was just so smart. He understood that Moscow, there's no way to defend Moscow. He also knew that there are these reinforcements that are trailing up from the Southern Army, and his army is becoming better equipped, better armed, and so on and so forth. All he has to do is hang on. And so what he does is he retreats, and he tells everybody. And believe me, I have seen parties where the cops show up, right, in Russia. And boy, when the cops show up, what do? You go home. It's time to go night-night. And when the loser tells you to get the hell out of Moscow, you get the hell out of Moscow. And what goes with it is the fire. Now, the fire department can't put out a large conflagration. What it can do is it can put out small fires that lead to conflagration. Napoleon moves into Moscow, sets up his headquarters in the Kremlin, then starts writing angry letters to the Tsar, Alexander I, saying, "Yeah, here I am, I'm in your capital. You come in here and surrender. I smashed your army," which, you know, maybe not. And Alexander never answers, ignores him. The next day, the fire breaks out. And you ought to see how Tchaikovsky hides the fire. And, you know, and it goes with the fact that I couldn't find that damn plaque on Papua. You know, they don't feel too good about this stuff, right? The fire breaks out, for those of you who've been in Moscow, if you stand in key type order. Now, if you stand at St. Basil's Cathedral, St. Basil's Cathedral is behind it. Tower of Ivory and the Terrible is over here on the left. There's a historical museum straight ahead. And about a mile and a half to the right is key type order. There's a subway station. So there's a subway station now at Park Pobiedy, where there is no plaque commemorating Napoleon's first view of Moscow. And there's a subway station in where the fire broke out. So the fire breaks out. They have trouble convincing Napoleon that he better get his butt out of there. But he goes along with it, and a wall collapsed and nearly took him out. Came very, very close to dying. And he went out and he hid with what the remains of his army, which has been bled down to under 100,000. Think about this. His army has been reduced by a factor of 5 on the way in. You know what'll happen to that reduction by a factor of 5? It'll be reduced by yet another 5. So here he is, after 2 or 3 days, the fire burns out, comes back into Moscow, and here he is. His goose is cooked. What's he gonna feed his horse? Where are they gonna find food? Now, I've read historians who say that, you know, there was plenty of food there for a month and a half. Now, what the hell good is food for a month and a half gonna do you in the middle of September, 700 miles into enemy territory? He knows that he's gotta get out. So what he does, he starts warning the Tsar that by God, he's gonna take his army, which has just been bled down to a rabble. Oh, by the way, he has more people now. All the expats, all the chefs, all the language teachers, all the governesses and governors, the Russians love to have their kids brought up by foreigners. That's the way they learn foreign languages. All the hoteliers, all these people, the ballet dancers, actresses, and ladies in other aspects of the entertainment. There, he's got 5,000 at least attached and seeking shelter from him, and everybody is scared. Now the problem is, if you go in and you tell Jacques to get up and get moving, and Jacques says, "Listen, Sarge, I'm warm and I'm hungry and I ain't moving," what the sergeant says is, "Jacques, I'm gonna count to three. And if you're not on your feet by the time I get to three, I'm gonna put a pistol ball in the middle of your foot." And what happens is, all, deux, and before he gets to trois, Jacques is on his feet and moving. But suppose it's a nursing mother. What do you do that? These are military people. How do you deal with a nursing mother under circumstances? So anyway, he says, "I'm going to go up to your capital up here at St. Pete's, and I'm going to burn it just like I burned Moscow." And Alexander the First knows, not a chance in hell. There's no way at all. So he said, "Well, what's wrong with just retreating due west?" Anybody? Why wouldn't he just go back the way he came in?
Same problem as nothing to eat.
What?
Same problem as nothing to eat.
I'm sorry.
Problem as nothing to eat. You burned it all.
Yeah, what are you going to eat? Exactly. This place is now a desert. It has been fought over by two armies. It has been depopulated. There isn't a chicken for 100 miles on either side of the road. Can't do that.
But you also have forces coming up from the south.
The Russians have forces coming up from the south. And so what he does is he goes south. The idea being that he can find his way by roads to Smolensk. And maybe go with the over in Smolensk. That's what he's thinking. Okay?
Yeah,
exactly. Well, Kutuzov takes a look at a map and says, "Ain't no way in hell." And what they do is they block the road here. And they force him up onto the road to Smolensk. And 2 days after they come up on that road, they find themselves in the battlefield of Buddy. Where over 70,000 came from. And it hasn't been cleaned up. And it has snowed and melted, The wolves have come down on the forest to dine on the corpses, the human corpses, the equine corpses. There are smashed wagons all over the place. There's unexploded ordnance all over the place. And it must have stunk. But he makes it past, and he starts towards Smolensk, and again Kutuzov comes under pressure. Head him off. He's getting away. And Kutuzov, the old guy, he was just so smart. What he did was he sicked his Cossacks. Now, I don't know whether or what you know about Cossacks, but the Cossacks speak Russian, but they're not Russian. And they are basically runaway serfs that have fled into the steppes. Now, the reason they have fled into the steppes is they know nobody in their right mind would chase them into the steppes. This is a bad neighborhood. And here's a whole bunch of these guys who've spent generations in a bad neighborhood. And what does that do to you? It makes you real. And what he does is he sicks them on Napoleon's army and on the poor civilians that were with it now. The women were hysterical. because they knew that if they fell into the hands or into the clutches of the Cossacks, the best thing that could happen to them was to die, and die quickly. And this hysteria from the civilians spreads to Napoleon's so-called Grand Army. As they go along, and there's you see pictures of the wildebeest migrating across the Serengeti, and the lions sort of follow them. The wildebeest can see the lions, and the lions can see the wildebeest. They're in sight of each other. Well, this is between the Grand Army and the Cossacks. These guys are riding around looking at the French army and just looking for maybe a wagon with a loose wheel, and if they see it, they take out their telescopes and they start looking at it. And if you're there in that wagon and you see them looking at your wagon, you're in bad, bad trouble. So what he does is the Cossacks chase Napoleon back to Smolensk. He's thinking of maybe spending the winter there, but he can't because the food and ammunition that he stashed has been stolen by the Russians, I think, right? And it's gone, and besides, he burned the city, so it's not exactly comfortable living. So what he has to do is retrace his steps down to Orsha. It's less of an issue now to get across the river because it's been so cold. It's just frozen up. And Napoleon says, listen, I'm sick and tired of dragging these pontoons. Set fire to them. And Lord be praised, the message didn't get through. The people in charge of the pontoons didn't get the email to burn. Because they crossed the Dnieper, middle of winter, it's November, and what happens? You get a midwinter fog. And all of a sudden, ice turns to liquid again. And all of a sudden, swamps become impassable. You gotta go around them. And he comes to a place in history. In French, they say, c'est la Bérezina. Now, you all know what c'est la guerre means. It's the war, shit happens. Okay? C'est la Bérezina is the most unspeakable disaster that you could possibly imagine. And this is what happens to Napoleon at the Berezina River. Now, for those of you who know Russian, Berioza is a birch tree, and the Berezina would have birch tree, and you have this sort of mental image of trees leaning over this indolent stream, people fishing for whatever. Here's what happened. He gets there, he comes to the Berezina, which is about here. It's in the upper drainage of the Dnieper. And lo and behold, the Russians, the full army, southern army, is waiting on the far side. All the heavy stuff, all the mortars, all the cannon, all the shot. The cavalry has made it up and already joined Kutuzov's army and so on and so forth. This is the big stuff. And it's on the other side of the river. Now imagine you're Napoleon. You've got the Cossacks behind you, nipping at your heels. Somewhere out there on your left is Kutuzov, with an army that's growing bigger every day. There's a river that can no longer, that can't be forded and is now open because of the thaw, right? And on the other side are the Russians. What are you going to do? So who told her? So Napoleon goes to his friend Davout and he said, well, take a bunch of guys, make a lot of noise, and go down the river as if you're looking for a ford or a bridge, which is laughable because the Russians burned every bridge for hundreds of miles. And what will happen is maybe this guy on the other side of the river, Chichagov, will bite on the fake and will follow. In the meantime, I will throw two pontoon bridges across the Dnieper up in the north. And if the Russians bite on the fake, you come back around, you make a 180, you come back up to the two bridges that I threw across the river, we'll get the army across. So Davout says, okay, I'll give it a try. Sure enough, he heads south, the Russians bite on the fake. Napoleon sends down a messenger to say, I got the bridges built, come on back up. He turns around, Napoleon gets his people, his army, across the Berezina. And then he does something that was probably justified from the standpoint of military tactics, but was utterly unthinkable, and that is, he burns his bridges. And God knows how many civilians, the wounded, the halt, the stacked stragglers, and so on and so forth, were trapped on the east side of the river. The Cossacks caught up with them and massacred over 15,000 of them. In the meantime, Napoleon is across the river with his army, and he's fighting Chichagov, and he loses at least 10,000. To Chichagov, because Chichagov by that time has all the heavy artillery, and the French are just about out. So he manages to break through, and he starts back up towards Vilnius. Shelby Foote, the great historian of the American Civil War, a Mississippian, by the way, had a technical term for what Napoleon did. He skedaddled. I am out of here. And Napoleon takes about six or eight trusted close friends and he skedaddles back to Paris, leaving his army to go on into Vilnius. Now, there's been no war in Vilnius. The Lithuanians said goodbye to the French way back in June. And then all of a sudden, these toothless, starving, lousy, filthy, unshorn wraiths descend on them like a herd of locusts. They smash into restaurants. They take carafes of vodka off of tables and just drink them down and take chicken bones out of people's hands and devour them and lay waste to kitchens and restaurants. And you're not supposed to do that. When you have been starved long enough and your stomach has shrunk, if you start eating and drinking too fast, you are letting yourself in for an extremely painful and humiliating death. And sure enough, about 10 years ago, somebody was putting in a parking lot in Vilnius. And they dug into a mass grave. And it was obviously French soldiers, or, you know, based on buttons and all the phones. It had to be that. So at any rate, again, Kutuzov is saying, he's getting away, and he got away. But Kutuzov said, look, let somebody else get out. Now, we did our job. We got him back across the Niemen River with as few casualties on our side as could possibly be done. And it was the 14th of December when he goes back across. Now, the interesting thing is, it's amazing what people can do when they're properly motivated. It took Napoleon 86 days. which is about it. Well, think about it. You know, if you had to walk from here to Fort Lauderdale, you know, it would be about taking 3 months. Right. On the way back out, that's in. On the way back out, 56 days. He cut it by a third because he was in a hurry. Because Kutuzov wanted him out, and Kutuzov knew how to get him. He said, "The concept." Okay. So that's the campaign. Napoleon would make it back to Paris. He raises a new army. They finally capture him in 1814. And in 1814 and 1815, there were Cossacks drilling on the Champs-Élysées. Think about that. You know, there was a song that we had in this country about World War I, and it went, "How you gonna keep on down on the farm after they've seen Paris?" Well, you can imagine what those Cossacks did after they'd seen Paris. Napoleon dies in 1821. Alexander I dies in 1825. There is an uprising, a short uprising. Again, you know, the having seen that much of the West, they wanted more. And Beethoven, remember him on the Third Symphony, who was going to piss on Napoleon's grave? Well, maybe he did, because he outlived him by about 5 years. That's it. Any questions, objections? And then we'll listen to some music. Nothing? No comments? Nothing? I used to have a physics professor who would lecture on some esoteric subject in physics, and I'd call for questions. And if he didn't get a question, you know what he did? He'd start the lecture. Okay. All right, yes, sir?
Yeah.
Hey, Steve,
yeah.
You want to give me a hand on this?
Sure.
It's the 1870s. They're having a world fair of Slavic. And all the Slavs from all the different parts of everything from the southeast in Bulgaria to the northwest in Poland and beyond get together to show what it is they have and what it is that makes them so wonderful because they're all Slavs. Now, that idea was very, very important back then, but we don't buy that anymore because basically all they found was they were very, very different people and they spoke very different languages. And all you have to do is take one look at Bulgarian and one look at Polish and you can see that how far apart the Slavic languages have drifted in a millennium. The Russian contribution to this fair was Tchaikovsky's "Boy, Didn't We Kick French Butt Back." It's been 60 years. Tchaikovsky was incredibly creative. He wrote ballets and symphonies and this and that and the other thing. He wrote a couple of, he wrote a violin concerto, which is called the Concerto Against the Violin. It's so hard to play. He was really something. As you listen to him, his sound seems familiar. You can get to it really easily because he was trained by Western. Now, there's another school of Russian music, symphonic music, led by Mussorgsky and Rimsky-Korsakov and Baratian, which is much more barbaric, to tell you the truth, as far as I'm concerned, much more interesting. You know, Night on Bald Mountain, with that trombone, that thing, a Mussorgsky, but this is Tchaikovsky. Now, what he will do in this is he will take each short theme and then repeat it. So you hear it once, and then just sort of store it in your mind and see if you recognize it when it comes back again. Okay. The French are the winds, the woodwinds and the brass. The Russians are the strings. So anytime you hear strings, he's talking about the Russians. Okay? Alright? Okay. Starts very quiet. Because this is a chant that the peasants sing in church. Suffering. stick around. That theme that you heard, feel for it. This is slow down. Tchaikovsky used to do to exert his Russianness was he would take themes from folk music, Russian folk music, and put them right into the middle of a string quartet. You know, so you listen to Haydn on steroids, and all of a sudden you get something like this. This is what makes Russian great. Out of chronological order, so you're going, well, you know, I'm waiting for the fire. You heard it. Just there is it. And a big build up to the battle of Lebanon. We'll be right back. the battles mixed up, but it's okay. Now we're back to Mother Russia. How does Mother Russia react to this terrible loss of her sons? Same old same. If it weren't the Mongols, it would be the Poles. If it weren't the Poles, it would be the Swedes. If it weren't the Swedes, it would be the French. And of course, you know, I really mean it. If it weren't the French, it would be the Germans. That's her. It's almost note for note. There is no change. This is bugger deep.
Thank you. Soda in the cooler, grab stuff.
The strings of the branch and the branch are both the wings and the legs. I could see, you know, you were just
Yes, I will never.